Today's speaker is Elena de la Rosa. She's a PhD student in the University of Malaga, and she's going to talk about the Hilbert type operator induced by radial wave. Elena, cuando quieras.
Thank you. I'm going to talk about a Hilbert type operator induced by a radial wave. That is a joint work with José Ángel Peláez. And I'm going to, at first, I'm going to introduce some notation. And we denote by D the unit disk, denote by H of D, the analytic functions on D. We defined the integral mean of order P for analytic function F by this expression, and we define the integral mean of order infinity by the supremum. And the classical Hardy space HP is defined by the analytic function such that the HP norm that is defined by the supremum over R between 0 and between 0 and 1 of the integral mean of order P is finite. And the block space that consists of the analytic function such that the block norm defined by this supremum is finite. And for an integrable function omega defined on the interval 0, 1 and that is non-negative, we can define the extension to D by omega of zeta equal to omega of the modulus of zeta. And then it is called a radial wave. And for a radial wave, we can define the Lebesgue space LP omega 0, 1, the space of measurable functions such that the norm in that space that is defined in this way is finite. And we can define and the Lebesgue space LP omega in a similar way with this norm. And the weighted Berman space AP omega consists of the analytic function such that belong to the Lebesgue space LP omega. And when omega is a radial wave alpha greater than minus 1, and then this space is called a standard Berman space and is denoted by AP alpha. For a radial weight omega, we define the integral tail of omega by omega hat of R, the integral between R and 1 of omega. And we assume that omega hat is always positive for all R in the open interval 0, 1. And because of for otherwise, the Berman space AP omega are all the analytic functions. So this case is not interesting. And for all x non-negative, we can define the moments of omega, omega x, by the integral between 0 and 1 of r to the power of x times omega. And it's clear that omega x is a decreasing function of x, so I'm going to use it repeatedly from now on. And we know that if omega is a radial wave, then the convergence in the A to omega space with its norm implies the uniform convergence in compact subsets of T. So A to omega is a closed subspace of L to omega, and the point evaluations are bounded linear functionals on A to omega. So risk representation theorem suggests that there exist functions in A to omega that are called reproducing kernels V omega zeta, such that the point evaluation can be expressed by the A to omega scalar product of F and the Bellman reproducing kernel that is given by this integral. And our problem is closely related with the Hilbert operator, so I'm going to recall some definitions and some interesting and previous results. The Hilbert matrix is this matrix. And this is a prototype of a Hankel matrix. We can define the Hilbert operator by multiplying each row of this matrix by the column of the coefficient of an analytic function. And then the Hilbert operator is defined by this series whenever this series is well defined and defines an analytic function. So some previous results. When f belongs to H1 and f belongs to H infinity, this series defines an analytic function, so the Hilbert operator is well defined, but the Hilbert operator isn't bounded in H1 and H infinity. Moreover, the Hilbert operator H is bounded in HP if and only if P is between 1 and infinity. And concerning the standard weighted Bellman spaces, the Hilbert operator is bounded in AP alpha if P is greater than 1 and alpha is greater than minus 1 and less than P minus 2. We know that the Hilbert operator has an integral representation given by this formula. And this formula plays a key role in words concerning the boundedness, the norm, and the spectrum of H. We can obtain another integral representation of this of the Hilbert operator by replacing the kernel 1 over 1 minus t zeta by another expression. Indeed, if I take the radial weight omega equal to 1, we know that the Bellman reproducing kernels of A2 omega, that is equal to A2, is given by this formula. So the kernel 1 over 1 minus t zeta can be expressed by this expression. That is equal to 1 over zeta, the integral between 0 and zeta of the Bellman reproducing kernels V omega t. So a natural question is, can we obtain similar results if I replace the kernel 1 over 1 minus t zeta by a kernel induced by a radial weight? That is, does the kernel 1 over 1 minus t zeta play a key role in the previous results? So with this purpose, we define the Hilbert type operator induced by a radial weight omega by the previous formula. And we denote by k omega t the kernel induced by the radial weight omega. That is equal to 1 over zeta integral between 0 and zeta of the Bellman reproducing kernels V omega t. So the problem is, as I said before, studying the action of the operator H omega on hardy and weighted Bellman spaces. A knowledge of the Bellman reproducing kernels V omega t will help us to deal with our problem because of the Bellman reproducing kernels are closely related with our kernels induced by a radial weight K omega t. So I'm going to say some comments about the background of the Bellman reproducing kernels. We know that if omega is a standard weight, then the Bellman reproducing kernel is given by this formula. So, development reproducing kernels has a neat formula and also they don't have zeros. So it's a particular case that is so comfortable. But unfortunately, it isn't true in general because of if omega is a radial weight, then the Berman reproducing kernels can have zeros and we don't have an explicit formula. So this is our first obstacle for study our problem. And then we use that the Berman reproducing kernels V omega zeta can be expressed by this series with En any orthonormal basis of A to omega. And we consider the normalized monomials in A to omega. So this sequence is orthonormal basis of A to omega. And then by using the last point, we can give an expression of the Berman reproducing kernels by this series in terms of the moments of omega. So from now on, I'm going to use this series. I'm going to start with the case p equal to infinity. We know that the Hilbert operator H is not bounded in H infinity, but this is a general phenomenon rather than a particular case because of the Hilbert type operator H omega is never bounded in H infinity. Indeed, if I take an X in the open interval 0, 1, and I apply the Hilbert type operator H omega to the constant function f equal to 1, we obtain this series. And then by using that omega n is greater than or equal to omega 2n plus 1, we obtain the second series. That is the power series of the logarithm of 1 over 1 minus x. So clearly, h omega is never bounded in h infinity for any radial weight omega. Moreover, the Hilbert operator H is bounded from H infinity to the Bloch space. So a natural question is obtaining a description of the radial weights omega such that the Hilbert type operator H omega is bounded from H infinity to the Bloch space. And the answer of this question is our first theorem. If omega is a radial weight, then the Hilbert type operator H omega is bounded from H infinity to the Bloch space if and only if there exists a positive constant such that omega hat of R is less than or equal to a constant times omega hat of 1 plus R over 2 for all R between 0 and 1. And what does it mean? If I take an interval, if I take an interval R1 and I divide it in half, the mass in the right half of the interval controls the mass in all the interval R1. And when a weight satisfies one, this condition, we say that omega belongs to the class T hat, or omega is an upper Darling weight. This class of weights appears in a natural way in the operator theory because of the class D hat describes the radial weight such that this Littlewood-Paley type inequality holds and also describes the radial weight such that the Berman projection I'm sorry. describes the radial weights at the Berman projection induced by a radial weight defined by this integral, and that is denoted by P omega, is bounded from L infinity to the Bloch space. And now I'm going to say some examples and some properties of this class of weights. Standard weights and the increasing weights V theta, defined by this formula with beta greater than 1, belong to the class D hat. Another example is that the exponential weights don't belong to the class D hat. And this example shows that a description of the class D hat provides a restriction in the decreasing of the weight. Because of a weight of the class D hat cannot decrease so fast when R goes to 1. And the third example, we can define a real sequence of numbers Rn by 1 minus 1 over 2 to the power of n with a natural n, and we can define a radial this radial weight by this series, and then this weight belongs to the class D hat. And this example shows that the class D hat admits an oscillatory behavior, and that a weight of the class D hat can be equal to zero in an interval of positive measure. And the next 2 points shows that the class D hat is not as innocent as it may looks like, because of if I take a radial weight of the class D hat and gamma is less than or equal to zero, such that 1 minus s to the power of gamma times omega is a weight, then this weight belongs to the class D hat. But, however, there exists a weight, an upper doubling weight omega, such that for all gamma greater than zero, all positive gamma, and this weight doesn't belong to the class D hat. And a concrete example can be found in a recent work of Elias and Raggia in 2020. And now we are ready to give a sketch of the proof. I remember the result. If omega is a radial weight, then the Hilbert type operator H omega is bounded from H infinity to the Bloch space, if and only if omega belongs to the class D hat. I would like to point out two ideas. We can find the derivative of H omega, and is given by this series, by this integral, where the kernel G omega is given by this series by using the series of the Berman reproducing kernels. And the second point is that omega belongs to the class D hat if and only if for each k greater than 1, there exists a positive constant such that the moments omega n is less than or equal to a constant omega k n for all natural n. And then we are ready to get an approach of the Bloch norm of h omega. And in the first inequality, we use that the h infinity norm of f is finite. And in the second step, we do the maths. And the third step is the key step of this proof, because of we use the description of the class D hat that I've said before. And then omega n is less than or equal to a constant omega 2n plus 1. And then we obtain the supremum that is finite. So we obtain the last inequality. And this inequality shows that the Hilbert type operator H omega is bounded from H infinity to the Bloch space. And now for show the necessity, we apply the boundedness of the Hilbert type operator H omega to the constant function f equal to 1. And we obtain the first inequality. And then by using the second inequality is by using the definition. And the third inequality is by taking the supremum only on an open interval 0, 1. So by taking this supremum, we obtain a real integral. And then by taking only a finite sum between 1 and n plus 1, we obtain the second inequality and doing the maths. And the next inequality is by taking x equal to 1 minus 1 over n. So, and by taking the sum between e of 3n over 4 and n plus 1, where e of x denotes the greatest natural such that is less than or equal to x. And then the last inequality is by using that omega x is a decreasing function of x, and by using that the number of terms of this finite sum is comparable to n. So we have obtained an inequality between the moments of omega, and then by iterating this inequality we obtain the description of an upper doubling weight omega. And this finished the proof. So now we are going to think about the boundedness in each one. We know, as I said before, that the classical Hilbert operator is not bounded in H1. And bearing in mind the result, we think about this, describing the doubling weight omega such that the Hilbert type operator H omega is bounded in H1. And the answer of this question is our next theorem. If omega belongs to the class T hat, then the following statements are equivalents. One, the Hilbert type operator is bounded in H1. Two, the measure mu omega defined by this expression, this formula, is a one Carlson measure for H1. And three, omega satisfies this condition. So now I'm going to give to point out the gain gradients for this proof. The equivalence between 2 and 3 follows from the Carlson theorem about describing the Q Carlson measures for each P. And to show the in order to show the sufficiency, we assume that that mu omega defined, as I said before, is a one Carlson measure for each one. And then we had to show that the Hilbert type operator is bounded in H1. So the K step of this implication is this estimate, the estimate of the integral mean, the integral mean of order one of our kernels K omega T. And then we are ready to get an approach of the H1 norm of H omega. The first inequality is by applying the Fubini's theorem. And the second inequality is by using the estimate of the integral mean of order one of the kernel K omega T. So we obtain this integral that is equal to the L1 norm of F with respect to the measure mu omega. And then by using that mu omega is a one Carlson measure for H1, we obtain the last inequality. And then this yes, that H omega is bounded in H1. And the key to show the necessity is this point estimate of the kernel K omega S of T with S and T real numbers between 0 and 1. And then by using this estimate and by using the classical test function for H1, by applying the boundedness, we obtain 3. So it finishes the proof of the boundedness of H1. And concerning the boundedness in HP with P between 1 and infinity, we study the problem of obtaining a description of the radial or doubling weight such that the Hilbert-Jacob operator H omega is bounded in HP. But this problem is open. We found some difficulties in the necessity of our condition because of we had to find a family of test functions, a family of analytic functions, and the appropriate family of functions involved characteristic functions, so they aren't analytic, and we found this problem in the necessity. But bearing in mind this inequality, that yes, that HP is contained in LP01, we think about the problem of describing the doubling weight such that the Hilbert type operator H omega is bounded from LP01 to HP. And then the answer of this problem is our next result. If omega is an upper doubling weight and p is between 1 and infinity, then the following statements are equivalent. The Hilbert type operator H omega is bounded from LP01 to the hard space HP. And 2, omega satisfies the condition 3, that is a Mackenhaus type condition for classical Hardy operators. And in particular, bearing in mind that HP is contained in LP01, as I said before, if 3 holds, then we obtain that the Hilbert type operator H omega is bounded in HP. I'm not going to say anything about this proof because of it's so similar to the proof of our next result. And concerning the boundedness in the weighted Berman space AP nu with P between 1 and infinity and nu a radial weight, we found the same problem in the necessity. So this estimate that can be obtained by an integration from the previous estimate yields that the weighted Berman space AP nu is contained in LP nu hat 01 and this embedding is sharp. So the question that we are thinking is obtaining a description of the doubling weights omega and the radial weights nu such that the Hilbert type operator H omega is bounded from LP nu hat 01 to the weighted Berman space AP nu. And then we obtain the following theorem. If P is between 1 and infinity and omega is an upper doubling weight, and nu is a radial weight on D, then the Hilbert type operator H omega is bounded from LP nu hat 01 to the weighted Berman space AP nu, if and only if the condition 4 holds, that is, this supremum holds, is finite. And in particular, because of the weighted Berman space AP nu is contained in LP nu hat 01, We obtain that if Hall holds the Hilbert type operator H omega is bounded from AP nu to AP nu. This result improves and generalizes a previous result of Peleth and Ratia because of we do not assume any integrability condition that in our case would be this this condition, and we do not need to assume that nu is a regular weight. I recall that a regular weight nu is a radial weight such that the integral mean in the interval R1 is comparable to nu of R for all R between 0 and 1. And now I'm going to give a sketch of the proof of the sufficiency. At first, I would like to point out that this inequality plays a key role on the proof of our result. This inequality can be found in works of Mantel-Jevic and Pavlovic and Flett. And this inequality relates the HP norm of an analytic function with the integral mean of the derivative of f. And then, through an integration, we obtain that for all 1 less than q less than p less than infinity and nu any radial weight, we obtain the following inequality. And then we are going to apply this inequality to the Hilbert type operator. And we obtain that the AP nu norm of H omega is less than or equal to this expression where appears the integral mean of order q of the derivative of H omega. So this inequality allows us to take the hypothesis in the theorem that nu is a radial weight. This is the key step that allows us to take this hypothesis. And also, it allows to get rid of the integral in the expression of the kernels, because of we had to find an approach when we have to obtain an approach of the derivative of H of omega. And and now, by applying the Minkowski inequality, we get that the integral mean of order q of the derivative of H omega, we get an approach of the integral mean of order q of the derivative of H of omega that is related with the integral mean of order q of the derivative of the kernel k omega. So we are ready to use a previous result of Peleth and Ratia about the needs of for integral means for the integral means of Berman of the Berman reproducing kernels induced by an upper doubling weight, because of the integral mean of order q of the derivative of our kernel k omega is less than or equal to a constant times the integral mean of order q of the Berman reproducing kernels, and then we use the estimate previously obtained. And then by joining the last three inequalities, we get this approach. And we want to control the second term of this the second term of this approach by the LP nu hat 01 norm of F. So we divide the inner integral by R, and we obtain a couple of classical Hardy inequalities that holds whenever this supremum is finite. So I would like to point out that we use tools of real analysis in this proof. This finishes the proof. And now I'm going to say some further comments. I recall the definition of the Berman projection induced by a radial weight omega that is defined by this integral and is denoted by P omega. And recently, in a work of Korhonen and Peláez and Ratia, they have observed a relation between the boundedness of the Berman projection of a radial weight P omega and the boundedness of a Hardy type operator. Indeed, they defined the radial aberration operator T omega by this integral, this expression. And they showed that if p is between 1 and infinity and nu and omega are regular weights, then the radial aberration operator is bounded from the Lebesgue space LP nu to the Lebesgue space LP nu, if and only if the Berman projection p omega is bounded in LP nu. So our next result shows a relation between the boundedness of the Berman projection P omega and the boundedness of our Hilbert-type operator H omega. But before, we need some definitions of the classes of weights. We say that omega belongs to the class T hat if there exist constants k and c greater than 1, such that omega hat of r is greater than or equal to a constant omega hat of 1 minus r over k for all r between 0 and 1. And we say that omega is a doubling weight, or omega belongs to the class T, if omega belongs to the class T hat and omega belongs to the class T check. And then this result shows the relation that I've said before. By joining our last result about the boundedness in Berman spaces of H omega and theorem 13 of Peláez and Ratia in a recent work, we obtain this result. If p is between 1 and infinity and nu is an upper doubling weight and nu is a radial weight, then the following statements are equivalent. The Berman projection is bounded from LP nu hat to the Berman projection, to the Berman space, weighted Berman space, AP nu hat. 2, omega belongs to D, nu belongs to D hat, and the Hilbert type operator H omega is bounded from the Lebesgue space LP nu hat 0, 1 to the weighted Berman space AP nu. 3, omega belongs to D, nu belongs to D hat, and D supremum is finite. And 4, omega belongs to D, nu belongs to D hat, and D supremum is finite. And D supremum is that appears in our theorem of the boundedness of H omega in Berman spaces. And so it finishes my talk. Thank you so much for your attention.
Okay, thank you, Elena, for your talk. Now it's time to some questions. So I talk to the audience. Do we have some questions for Elena? Okay, it seems to me that the Oscar, whenever you want, please.
Sorry, I was waiting for somebody else to ask a question, but I will be the first.
Okay.
Okay, so first of all, thank you very much, Elena. I see that you've done a very, very good job, and you have studied quite a bit this new operator H omega. But I have just a single question, which I wanted to know whether you have addresses or not. Have you tried, when you said that the case H omega being bounded from HP into HP for P between 1 and infinity is open, right?
Sí, yes.
Yes, so is it anything done for P equals 2?
Or you, for you, P equals, for P equal to 2?
Yes, if you have some information or not, because it seems to be a much simpler situation.
Yes, I've not thought about this. No, I think that yes, I think that is an easier case, and it may be maybe would easier, but I've not thought about this. No.
Okay, no problem. And another thing, since you have done such a complete study, I am wondering about the following question. You are motivating always starting with the classical Hilbert matrix, and you just claim that it doesn't map H1 into H1. Fine. And then you want to study the situation in this H omega. But my question would be, you probably know, I'm sure, that this H with it for the weight constant, it's mapping L log L into H1. So you have a much smaller space which makes the operator to run into H1. Have you thought in an analogous for the H omega? Can you find some space, or you didn't think on this?
I've not thought about this.
But I guess that probably is something to study, huh? Because
yes, it's interesting. Maybe for a future plan.
Yes, probably is something interesting, yes. Okay, so yes. Thank you very much. I really enjoyed very much your talk.
I'm sorry.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you, Oscar, for your questions. Do we have further questions?
Okay, yes, I will make a question. First of all, it was a very nice talk, but let me see. You said that the Hilbert operator is bounded from H infinity into the Bloch space. And then this was the motivation of studying the boundedness of H omega from H infinity into the Bloch space. But I think that actually the Hilbert operator is bounded from H infinity into BMOA. Have you studied the question of the boundedness of H omega into BMOA or not?
No, we have commented something because of BMOA is contained in the block space, so omega belongs to the class G hat would be a necessary condition, but the sufficiency we have not thought.
Okay. It was very nice.
It's a future plan, yes, it's interesting.
To think about, I believe. Okay, yeah, thank you. Yes.
I'm sorry.
No, this was perfect, it was.
Okay. Thank you, Daniel, for your question. Further question for Elena? No? Then I think that is the right time to give thanks again to Elena for her nice talk.
Thank you.